Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy for the date 7th of November 2019. Displayed are the list of news articles taken up for today's analysis, along with the page numbers of Chennai, Bengaluru, Delhi, Trivandrum and Hyderabad editions. The handwritten notes in PDF format and the timestamping of all the news articles taken up for today's analysis is available in the description section and also in the comment section for the benefit of the smartphone users. Let us now start our analysis. This news article is about an ultimatum given by the National Green Tribunal to ban certain types of reverse osmosis systems. So with reference to this news article, we'll be focusing more on the process of osmosis, then the process of reverse osmosis, then about the reverse osmosis system and how the use of reverse osmosis system leads to wastage of water, and also the present order that has been issued by the National Green Tribunal. The syllabus that is relevant to the analysis of this news article is given here for your reference. First, let us see what is meant by osmosis. As you can see in this picture, consider an environment where there are two water mediums. In one water medium, the salt concentration is low, and in the other water medium, the salt concentration is high. And both these mediums are separated by a semi-permeable membrane. Osmosis is a process where the water moves through semi-permeable membrane from an area of low salt concentration into an area or region with higher salt concentration. Now, why water moves in such a way is to equalize the concentrations on both the sides under natural conditions. If you see, the trees and roots absorb minerals through osmosis process. Now, let us see the reverse osmosis process. The exact opposite of osmosis is reverse osmosis. So, in case of reverse osmosis, an external pressure is applied to overcome the osmotic pressure. So because of this external pressure, the water is being forced to move through the semi-permeable membrane from an area or region of higher salt concentration to an area or region of lower salt concentration, as you can see in this picture. The main purpose of using this reverse osmosis process is to purify the water. And also reverse osmosis is used for desalination process. If you see, there are two desalination plants which are set up in Chennai using reverse osmosis process. So this is the main use of reverse osmosis process. And all those systems which are based on this reverse osmosis process are known as reverse osmosis system. Note that the quality of the membrane, that is the semi-permeable membrane, determines the purity of the reverse osmosis system. And in turn, the price of the reverse osmosis purifiers is also directly related to the quality of the membrane that is being used. So if the system is costly, it means that the quality of the membrane is good. Now, know that one way of measuring the purity of water is based on total dissolved solids. Total dissolved solids is made up of inorganic salts as well as small amounts of organic matter. And as per a study by World Health Organization, if the TDS levels are below 300 milligram per liter, then the water is considered to be excellent quality. While if the water contains TDS which ranges up to 900 milligram per liter, then the water quality is said to be poor. And if the TDS levels are above 1200 milligram per liter, then the water quality is unacceptable. So this is the TDS level that you need to know. Now let us see the present ruling given by the National Green Tribunal. This ruling is based on a plea by one of the non-governmental organization. In this plea, the NGO sought the conservation of potable water by preventing its wastage on account of unnecessary use of reverse osmosis systems. Now in this context, we need to know why there is wastage of water in reverse osmosis systems, as well as unnecessary use of reverse osmosis system. Based on the expert committee that was constituted by the National Green Tribunal, the efficiency of the reverse osmosis systems depend on the quality of the membrane used. And if you see, most of the reverse osmosis systems efficiency ranges between 20% to 60%. It means that for every 10 liters of impure or raw water, only about 2 to 6 liters of water is extracted and the remaining water goes as waste. In addition, you need to note that the reverse osmosis systems should not be used if the TDS of the raw water is less than 500 milligram per liter. Why? Because if the reverse osmosis purification is used again, then even the useful minerals that are present in this water with a TDS of less than 500 milligram per liter will also be removed along with the unwanted impurities. Now, this is not considered good for the health as the required minerals will also be removed. Therefore, the National Green Tribunal has directed the Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change of the Government of India to issue a notification in the month of May this year, that is May 2019. As per the ruling given by the National Green Tribunal in May 2019, the Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change may issue appropriate notification that prohibits the use of reverse osmosis system where the TDS in water is less than 500 milligram per liter, and wherever reverse osmosis is permitted, then requirement needs to be laid down for the recovery of water. The recovery of water shall be more than 60%, that is the efficiency of the RO purifiers shall be more than 60%. And one more provision was mandated to be laid down by the ministry, that is from the reject water of this RO system, further water shall be recovered, and this recovery shall be up to 75%. It simply means the recovery of the reject water from the RO system. And whatever water that is recovered from the reject of the RO system shall be used for purposes like washing of utensils, then for flushing in the washrooms, then it can be used for gardening purposes, then it can also be used for cleaning of vehicles and even floor cleaning as well, and also for certain other requirements. The National Green Tribunal also ordered that the directions be issued for the enforcement of extended producer's responsibility. Now, what is this extended producer's responsibility? It is nothing but for RO system, certain cartridges and membranes need to be used. Now, as per this extended producer's responsibility, the manufacturers of these cartridges and semi-permeable membranes shall be responsible for their disposal. Also, these manufacturers need to provide proper labeling on the purifier that shall specify that the unit should be used if the TDS is more than 500 milligram per liter. So, this was also ordered by the National Green Tribunal to be enforced by the ministry. And this news article is about the non-compliance of the above order that we discussed, which was issued in the month of May this year. So, to conclude this news article, we have discussed about the process of osmosis, then the process of reverse osmosis, then about RO systems, that is the reverse osmosis systems, and the National Green Tribunal order. Now, have a look at the practice question. Let us move on to the next news article. This news article states that the Union Cabinet, chaired by the Prime Minister of India, has approved the creation of an alternative investment fund of 25,000 crore. Actually, the Union Cabinet approved the establishment of a special window fund. This fund is to provide priority debt financing for the completion of stalled housing projects that are in the affordable and middle income housing sector. In simple terms, this fund will provide relief to developers that require funding to complete a set of unfinished projects, and thus consequently this will ensure the delivery of homes to the home buyers. It is needed because according to the government's estimates, there are more than 1600 housing projects in which 4.58 lakh crore units are stalled or delayed. In this, what do we mean by affordable housing? The task force on promoting affordable housing of the Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs has defined affordable housing as any housing that meets some form of affordability criterion, which could be the income level of the family or the size of the dwelling unit or the affordability in terms of EMI size or the ratio of house price to annual income. Now, with respect to the special window fund, the government shall act as the sponsor. Here, a sponsor is any person or entity which sets up the alternative investment fund. The total commitment that is to be infused by the government would be up to 10,000 crore. But the newspaper states it as 25,000 crore. According to the article, the fund size will initially be 25,000 crore, in which the government will provide 10,000 crore and the balance will be provided by the State Bank of India and Life Insurance Corporation. Now, this special window fund will be set up as a Category 2 AIF debt fund that is registered with SEBI. Here, AIF stands for Alternate Investment Fund. Now, let us see what are these Alternate Investment Fund and Category 2 Alternate Investment Fund. In India, Alternative Investment Funds or AIFs are defined in Regulation 2.1B of Securities and Exchange Board of India, Alternative Investment Funds Regulations of 2012. According to this regulation, Alternative Investment Fund means any fund that is established or incorporated in India. It is a privately pooled investment vehicle which collects funds from the sophisticated investors, whether from Indian sources or from the foreign sources, and they will invest it in accordance with a defined investment policy for the benefit of its investors. The privately pooled investment vehicle can be in the form of a trust or in form of a company or in form of a body corporate or even in form of a limited liability partnership. Hence, in India, alternate investment funds are private funds which otherwise do not come under the jurisdiction of any regulatory agency in India. As per 2012 regulations, the alternative investment funds shall seek registration in one of the three categories. First is a Category 1 Alternate Investment Fund. Here, the alternate investment funds which set up in startup or early stage ventures or those alternative investment funds which invest in social ventures or small and medium sized enterprises, that is SMEs or infrastructure or other sectors or areas which the government or regulators considered as socially and economically desirable are Category 1 Alternative Investment Funds. This shall include venture capital funds, then the SME funds, then social venture funds, then infrastructure funds and such other alternative investment funds as Category 1 Alternative Investment Funds. Now, don't go into detail of what is meant by all these funds. Just remember that these funds come under Category 1 Alternative Investment Funds. The second is Category 2 Alternative Investment Funds. Those alternative investment funds which do not fall in Category 1 and 3 come under this Category 2. Then further, those alternative investment funds which do not undertake leverage or borrowing other than to meet the day-to-day operational requirements are categorized as Category 2 Alternative Investment Funds. And leverages as permitted in the SEBI Alternative Investment Funds Regulations of 2012 also come under this Category 2 Alternative Investment Funds. Now, various types of funds such as real estate funds, private equity funds, that is PE funds, then funds for distressed assets, then debt funds, etc. are registered as Category 2 Alternative Investment Funds. Now, in our context, we saw that special window fund will be set up as a Category 2 Alternative Investment Debt Fund. So let us just see what is a debt. Debt fund is an alternative investment fund which invests primarily in debt or debt securities of the listed investee companies or unlisted investee companies according to the stated objectives of the fund. Don't forget that these funds are registered under Category 2. In this regard, since alternative investment fund is a privately pooled investment vehicle, the amount contributed by the investors shall not be utilized for the purpose of giving loans. Further, Category 1 and Category 2 alternative investment funds are required to be close-ended. Here, the term close-ended means having a predetermined limit or boundary. So, they have a minimum tenure of 3 years in this case. Third is the Category 3 alternative investment funds. Those alternative investment funds which employ diverse or complex trading strategies are categorized as Category 3 alternative investment funds. Alternative investment funds such as hedge funds or funds which trade with a view to make short-term returns or such other funds which are open-ended and for which no specific incentives or concessions are given by the government or any other regulator are categorized as Category 3 alternative investment funds. Category 3 alternative investment funds may be open-ended or close-ended. Now, let us see the advantages of this initiative of the government, that is the advantages of creation of an alternative investment fund of ₹25,000 crore. Now, we know that the real estate industry is intrinsically linked with several other industries. So, the growth in the sector will have a positive effect. Hence, it will release the stress in other major sectors of the Indian economy as well. So, it is expected to revive the demand for building materials such as cement, iron and steel. So, all these sectors will be revived consequently. This move in turn is likely to generate jobs as human resources needed to finish the pending projects. Initially, we saw that this move will ensure delivery of homes to the home buyers, Hence, the move and the fund will generate commercial return for its investors. Then there are many genuine developers who are solvent, that is, they are able to pay their debts, but still they are facing liquidity challenge. This challenge is due to various reasons, such as poor sales of homes or apartments. And the other reason is that the buyers prefer ready-to-move-in apartments. But to have a ready-to-move-in apartment, the project needs to be completed for which the fund is required. So this funding will enable such developers to complete their projects. So this is all from this news article which you need to know from exam point of view. Now have a look at the practice question. Let us move on to the next news article. Next, let us see an editorial. In this editorial, the author discusses about the threat that is posed by climate change and the sea level rise to the people living in coastal areas, then about its impacts and what India must do to alleviate its impacts. The syllabus that is relevant to the analysis of this editorial is given here for your reference. Before moving on to the editorial, first let us understand what is meant by climate change migration. As we know, the results of climate change is changed weather pattern, such as variation in the average rainfall and temperature, which results in conditions like flood, drought, rise in sea level, then even degradation of land and the ecosystem. So when the ecosystem around us is affected, then the livelihood is also affected. So an individual is forced to move out of his or her locality when the ecosystem is affected. Now, in case of people living in the coastal areas, they might be forced to move inland or to cross the borders to other countries. So these migrants or refugees can be called as environmental refugees. So environmental refugees can be defined as those people who have been forced to leave their traditional habitat either temporarily or permanently because of a marked environmental disruption. It can be natural and or triggered by people. So it has affected their existence and it has also seriously affected the quality of their life. And also because it might have affected their existence in that particular area, or it might have also affected the quality of their life in that area, which made them to move. And one also needs to note that the already existing problems in the region, like scarcity of resources, conditions like poverty, internal conflict, etc., can be exacerbated by climate change. That is, all these problems will even become more bigger in the future. So this is why climate change is often referred to as threat multiplier. Now, in this editorial, the author is speaking about one such cause for climate change migration, which is the sea level rise or SLR. If you see in our 30th October Hindu News analysis, we have explained in detail that 36 million Indians, that is 3.6 crore Indians, face flood risk due to rising sea levels. And these new estimates were based on a new software which is called as Coastal DEM or the Coastal Digital Elevation Model. At present, the estimates on risks posed by flooding are based on the maps of Earth that are taken by Shuttle Radar Topography Mission. Know that this is a mission of NASA, that is the National Aeronautics and Space Administration, which is the space agency of the country of United States of America. By this mission, high-resolution digital elevation data of the entire Earth is captured. Now, as per the new estimates, which is based on the new software called Coastal DEM, the number of Indians who would be affected by rising sea levels may have been underestimated by as much as 88%. This is because if global emissions continue to rise in India, almost 36 million, that is 3.6 crore Indians, would face annual flooding by the year 2050, and this may increase up to 44 million, that is 4.4 crore by the year 2100. So this data is much larger than the previous estimates. Now, if you would like to know more about these new estimates and the new model for calculating the elevations, please refer to our 30th October analysis. Now, let us look at the editorial. In this editorial, the author is of the opinion that getting accurate sea level rise projections is always a difficult task. This is because the sea level rise varies with many factors like the expansion of warm waters in the seas, then due to melting of glaciers, and also because of the subsidence of land. But the common agreement is that if high emissions of greenhouse gases were to continue, then the average global sea level rise could be as high as 2 meters by the end of this century, that is by the year 2100. In this context, let us now discuss in detail about the impacts of rising sea level, which can be useful for the exams. Some of the adverse effects of rising sea level are coastal flooding, that is the coast can be flooded with water, then salt water intrusion into the land can happen from the sea. Next, the coastal infrastructure might get destructed or get affected. And also those communities, especially the coastal communities which are living near the sea line, will be affected or destructed. And also the coastal ecosystems will be put into danger. So all these will have an overall impact on the entire economy. So when the sea level rise increases more than what is expected, its effects will also be much more. Also, people living along the coast will be forced to move inland, probably to the nearby towns and cities. And in case of small island nations or in low-lying delta regions like in the country of Vietnam, this is not possible. That is, they cannot move to nearby towns or cities. So the people will be forced to move across borders because there will be geographical limitations. So the author is telling that this will severely impact the political stability of the region because now they'll become environmental refugees. According to the author, the most affected due to sea level rise would be the people who are living in the continent of Asia, especially from countries like China, Bangladesh, India, and many other island nations. And according to author, in India, the most affected cities would be the cities of Mumbai and Kolkata, where the author is telling that a major portion of both these cities would submerge under the sea by the year 2050. In the later part of the editorial, the author talks about what should be India's future policies or what should be India's future stand. The author tells that first of all, we must accept that climate change is real and the challenges that are posed by climate change is also real. Now you can include a point here telling that not just India but the entire world countries should try their best to achieve the goals of Paris Climate Agreement. That is, they should work towards meeting the nationally determined contributions under the Paris Climate Agreement. Next, the author is of the opinion that India must focus on protecting the coast through measures like having natural barriers or levees or flood barriers or even hard barriers for preparing for the sea level rise. Here the term levee is nothing but an embankment that is built to prevent the overflow of a river. Then the other measure is to stop the infrastructure construction along the coast and integrate, that is combine the anticipated sea level rise effects into coastal planning activities. So this will reduce the exposure of risk to the investors, then to the builders and also to the insurance companies. The author tells that there should be plans to retreat from the most vulnerable areas well ahead of time. So this would reduce the impacts on infrastructure and also the impacts on human lives. The next measure is integrating the proposals for new migrants in future urban policies. As we know, climate change migration is a reality. And in India, the coastal population, when they are threatened, will definitely move towards inland areas. So these inland areas must be well prepared and planned for this migration. Otherwise, it will result in internal security issues. So the author is telling that in this scenario, the government should take initiatives to increase the openness of people who are living in inland or rural areas. If their own livelihood is at risk, then they will not be open to migrants from other places, even if they are Indians. So the author tells that the government should invest more in rural economy in such a way that unemployment and poverty is reduced. So this will improve the sustainability of the livelihood of the rural people. And once they are more resilient to risks, then they will be open to others. In this case, the environmental refugees or those people who move from coastal areas towards inland or rural areas. Next, the author tells that India should not fortify its borders against cross-border climate refugees. He tells that it cannot be justified in practical terms and also in ethical terms. Hence, the author suggests that India and its neighbors must collaborate on developing regional agreements for migration, then regional policies for labor and skill development, etc. As we have discussed, South Asia is one of the most vulnerable regions to climate change. The author says that considering our shared ecological zones, borders, coastlines, languages, and histories, we must take coordinated efforts to manage the extreme events. So the author here emphasizes regional coordination. This must also address the most pressing issue of cross-border migration, because the author is of the opinion that we cannot classify migrants as political migrants or climatic migrants, because the causes for migration are interlinked, according to the author. So the author emphasizes that the discussions on the rights of migrants should cover all classes of migrants. So these are some of the policies which the author tells that the government should pursue. To summarize this editorial, we have seen the threats that are posed by climate change and sea level rise to those people who are living in the coastal areas, then the impacts of sea level rise and what India must do to alleviate the impacts of sea level rise in the future. Now have a look at the practice question. Let us move on to the next news article. This news article is with reference to the issue of forming government in the Maharashtra state. The syllabus that is relevant to the analysis of this news article is given here for your reference. See, recently the elections for the State Legislative Assembly of Maharashtra was held in October 2019. And if you see in the state of Maharashtra, there are totally 289 seats in the State Legislative Assembly. And among them, members for 288 seats are directly elected and one member is nominated. So, to form a government in Maharashtra conveniently by a single party, that particular party should have at least 50% plus one seat. That is, it should have a simple majority of at least 145 seats. But if you take the recent election results in Maharashtra, none of the parties which contested the elections have this simple majority. So, as a next move, some parties should come together to form a government, and if they are coming together, then this government will be called as a coalition government. Here, those who come together should have at least 145 members among the coalition parties in order to win a simple majority in that particular state legislative assembly. Now, the issue with Maharashtra is that even though the results were announced on 24th October 2019, till now, no leader or no party commands a simple majority by taking into the confidence of members of other parties also. That means a government can never be formed if this trend is going to continue. Now, what if it continues for an unlimited period? That means what will happen if no one could claim majority to form the government? Then there are two options. One option is conducting a fresh election, and the second option is the governor proclaiming for the president rule in the state. According to the news article, it states that the governor of Maharashtra has no intention of imposing president's rule in the state in a hurry. It means that the governor is in the wait and watch mode to see whether any leader could claim majority or not. Most probably, if no one could claim formation of the government by 9th of November, then the governor may impose president's rule in Maharashtra. So the governor is adopting wait and watch approach, because if some parties come together and try to form a coalition government, then whatever money spent by the government for the recent elections will have some meaning. Note that if president's rule is imposed, then both the legislative and executive powers of the state will be taken by the central government. Generally, the state legislature is either dissolved or suspended. Here, when the state legislature is dissolved, the MLAs lose their membership, and when the legislature is under suspension, that is suspended animation, then the members do not lose their membership, but they cannot enact laws for the state. And know that the maximum period that is prescribed for the operation of president's rule is 3 years. The proclamation for the president rule is made by the president under Article 356 of Indian Constitution. The proclamation can be made by the president of India with the receipt of a report from the governor of a state, or even without a report from the governor. And this news article talks about governor, because if government could not be formed, then the governor may send a report to the president to proclaim the rule of the president in the state. And once the rule is proclaimed, then both the houses of the parliament, that is both Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha, have to approve within 2 months from the date of proclamation. And once approved by the parliament, the president rule continues for 6 months. And this president's rule can be extended by the approval of the parliament for a subsequent period of 6 months, Whatever be the case, it can be extended till the total period reaches a time frame of 3 years. And beyond 3 years, the president's rule must end and normal constitutional machinery must be restored in the state. That is, either legislative assembly has to be reactivated from suspended animation or fresh elections have to be conducted to form the state executive, that is the chief minister and council of ministers. Let us see the case of Maharashtra now. With respect to Maharashtra, note that none of the elected representatives who have won the recent elections have taken the oath of office as a member of legislative assembly. In this scenario, if the president's rule is proclaimed, then there are two possibilities. One possibility is that after the imposition of president rule, if there is a possibility for the parties to come together to form a coalition government, then a government may be formed in the state of Maharashtra and meanwhile the president rule can be removed from the state. The second possibility is that if no parties come together, then president rule will be there in the state till the situation becomes conducive for the election commission to conduct fresh assembly elections. This means fresh assembly elections will be conducted after some point of time. These are some of the information with reference to the analysis of this news article. Let us move on to the next news article. This news article is regarding the order by Supreme Court with respect to the appointment of information commissioners. As we know, the information commissioners are appointed under the Right to Information Act of 2005. The syllabus that is relevant to the analysis of this news article is given here for your reference. First, let us see the Supreme Court order. Then we shall be seeing the difference between the Central Information Commissioner and the State Information Commissioners. Now, coming to the Supreme Court order, in February 2019, the Supreme Court passed an order regarding the appointment of information commissioners. Then the Supreme Court had said that both the central government and the state governments have failed to appoint the information commissioners on a timely manner against the existing vacancies. Then the Supreme Court had also observed that the Central Information Commission and the State Information Commissions have become the bastions for both the serving and retired bureaucrat. Then the Supreme Court had also asked the government to look beyond the coterie of retired bureaucrats. Here the term coterie means small and exclusive group of people with shared interests. Here one thing to be noted is the section 12 of the RTI Act of 2005. This section 12 of RTI Act says that the Chief Information Commissioner and the Information Commissioners shall be persons of eminence in public life with wide knowledge and experience in law, science and technology, social service, management, journalism, mass media, or administration and governance. This means that the Act itself envisages the appointment of Information Commissioner and the appointment of Chief Information Commissioner and the other Information Commissioners from varied domains. As we know, the Right to Information Act of 2005 is one of the most empowering legislations in the history of independent India. It helps the people to raise objections, then make the government accountable, and also to make the governance more transparent. But the present issues like not filling the existing vacancies and bias in favor of bureaucrats in appointment, etc., will defeat the purpose of the Act itself. According to this news article, the Supreme Court had now ordered the center and 8 states such as Andhra Pradesh, Maharashtra, Karnataka, Kerala, etc. to present a report card on the appointments made to the information commissions. We can hope that this will bring a solution to the problems. Now, we will briefly compare the Central Information Commission and the State Information Commission. Note that the Central Information Commission or CIC entertains complaints and appeals pertaining to offices, public sector undertakings, etc., which are under the control of central government and union territories. And the State Information Commissions entertain the complaints and appeals pertaining to offices, then public sector undertakings, etc., under the concerned state governments. Now let us discuss the organizational structure and appointment. The Central Information Commission consists of a Chief Information Commissioner and not more than 10 Information Commissioners. And all of them are appointed by the President on the recommendation of a committee. This committee shall consist of Prime Minister, who is the chairperson, then the leader of opposition in the Lok Sabha, and a union cabinet minister who is to be nominated by the Prime Minister. Now, let us see the State Information Commission. The State Information Commission consists of a Chief Information Commissioner and not more than 10 Information Commissioners. And they are appointed by the Governor of that particular state on a recommendation of a particular committee. This committee shall consist of the Chief Minister of that particular state, who is the chairperson, then the leader of the opposition of the Legislative Assembly in that particular state, and the State Cabinet Minister of that particular state, who is to be nominated by the Chief Minister. Next, let us discuss the tenure. First, we will see with respect to the Central Information Commission. The Chief Information Commissioner and other Information Commissioners shall hold office for a term of 5 years or until they attain the age of 65 years, whichever is earlier. And know that they are not eligible for reappointment. And this tenure is also the same for the State Information Commission. So, the Chief Information Commissioner and the Information Commissioners of the respective State Information Commissions shall also hold office for a term of 5 years or until they attain the age of 65 years, whichever is earlier. Now, let us discuss the procedure for removal. The President can remove the members of the Central Information Commission on the ground of proved misbehavior or incapacity. But if you see, this can be done only after an inquiry by the Supreme Court into the set cause for removal. And the President can also remove the members of Central Information Commission on the following grounds. If that particular member is adjudged as an insolvent, then if that member engages in any other paid employment during his term of office, which is the office of profit, then if that member is unfit to continue due to infirmity of mind or body, that is because of physical or mental weakness in the opinion of the President, etc. Here, a person who is adjudged as an insolvent means he or she has been declared as unable to pay debt or liabilities by a judicial procedure. And in case of the State Information Commissions, the Governor can remove the members of the State Information Commission on the ground of proved misbehavior or incapacity, but this can be done only after a Supreme Court inquiry into the said cause of removal. Here, note that it is not the High Court, but again the Supreme Court. The Governor can also remove the members on the grounds if the member is adjudged as an insolvent or if that member engages in any other paid employment during his term of office or if that member is unfit to continue due to infirmity of mind or body, etc. So, from this article, we have seen the Supreme Court order with respect to the appointment of Information Commissioners for the Central Information Commission and also for the State Information Commissions. And also regarding the office of the Central Information Commission and the State Information Commission. To know more on the RTI Act of 2005 and some of the important provisions and detailed comparisons of both the Central Information Commission and the State Information Commission, please refer to our 12th October Hindu News analysis. Let us move on to the practice questions discussion session. See the first question. The question is, consider the following statements with reference to reverse osmosis systems. They have given four statements and they have asked you to choose the correct statements. The first statement, it tells that the RO systems are based on reverse osmosis process in which under external pressure, water moves from low salt concentration region into high salt concentration through semi-permeable membrane. This statement is wrong because osmosis is a process where the water moves from low salt concentration region into high salt concentration region through a semi-permeable membrane. But in case of a reverse osmosis process, there will be an external pressure. Under the external pressure, the water will move from the high salt concentration region into low salt concentration region through a semi-permeable membrane. So, the first statement is wrong here. Now, see the second statement. It tells that the RO systems are used in the purification of the impure water. This statement is correct. It is mainly used for purification of water and it is also used to convert the salt water into potable water. Now, see the third statement. It tells that the RO purifiers remove only unwanted salts. Here, you have to note that though RO purifiers remove unwanted salts, but they can also remove wanted or useful minerals as well. So, the third statement is wrong. Always be careful when there are superlatives like only. Read the statement again and make sure if that statement is correct or not. Now, see the fourth statement. It tells that the extended producer's responsibility also applies to RO systems See, as per a direction of NGT, that is the National Green Tribunal, in May 2019, extended producers' responsibilities also applicable to the RO systems. Under this extended producers' responsibility, those manufacturers who produce the cartridges and membranes have to make sure they are properly disposed. And this order also directed the manufacturers to provide proper labeling on the purifier to specify that the unit should be used if a TDS is more than 500 milligram per liter. So the fourth statement given here is correct. Now the question has asked you to choose the correct statements. The correct answer is option B, 2 and 4 only. Now see the next question. The question is, consider the following statements with reference to alternative investment funds. They have given two statements. The first statement is the definition, and the second statement is the definition for category 3 alternative investment funds. Here the first statement is correct. It is the definition of alternative investment funds. And know that there are three categories of alternative investment funds: category 1 alternative investment fund, category 2 and category 3. Here the given description is not the definition for category 3 alternative investment funds, but it is the definition for category 1 alternative investment funds, as we saw during our discussion. Now this question has asked for the correct statements. The correct answer is option A, 1 only. Now see the mains question. The question is, recent studies are telling that Asian countries, including India, are the most vulnerable to sea level rise due to climate change. Discuss the impacts of rising sea levels. What can India include in its future policies to mitigate these effects? This question has to be addressed in 250 words and 15 marks allotted for this question. You can split this question into three parts, three statements, three parts. For the first statement, you just give an intro quoting the study which tells that India is vulnerable to sea level rise due to climate change. And in the second part of the question, it directly asks you to discuss the impacts of rising sea levels. So try to address this in 80 to 100 words. And the intro ideally should address in 40 to 50 words. Now see the third part, it asks you, what can India include in its future policies to mitigate these effects? This statement is basically a suggestion. So try to give the suggestions from different angles. And this part can also be addressed in 80 to 100 words. And finally conclude the answer in 30 to 40 words. You can post your answers in the comment section for this question. The answers will be moderated and suggestions would be given in the next 5 to 7 working days by our team. With this, we come to the end of the analysis of all the news articles taken up for today's discussion and also the practice questions discussion session. Do like, comment and share the video, and do subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for latest videos and updates. Stay focused and motivated, friends. Thank you.